In this video, we're going to talk about what a linear crossover is and how to do it. Now, I am not Daryl Belfry, so I am nowhere near qualified to talk about what a linear crossover is, truthfully, but I'm going to give it my best shot. Now, my name is Jason Yee. This is Train 2.0. I'm a professional hockey player and kinesiologist, and like I said, in this video, we're going to do our best to talk about what a linear crossover is. And I like this article by Frank Severalli. You've probably seen this. It's one of the top-ranking articles that you see pop up when you type in linear crossover or McDavid or Crosby. And we talk about how the crossovers literally set players apart. And it's the amount of crossovers. But then people often get confused with the what a linear crossover is. And I kind of like this quote. "The description of linear crossovers sounds much more awkward than it looks. You've probably seen it dozens of times in a game without noticing it specifically." And what is that definition? It's not like skating around a circle, but rather crossing their feet in acceleration at top speed while skating in a straight line. So we'll break this down, show some examples, and here's an example right here of McDavid using the linear crossovers, so to speak. There's one there, and then off we go. So that's just an example of it. And we'll go over a few more examples. We'll talk about how to implement it, and how they're often used in a game. But like I said, I'm nowhere near qualified to actually talk about this. This is just my best guess, and I'm hoping it's helpful to you. So let's go back to this. WTF is a linear crossover? Well, before we talk about what it is exactly, I want to talk about the 80-20 of hockey and the skills that separate. A lot of you are familiar with the 80-20 principle, Pareto's principle, which is that 80% of results often come from 20% of things you do, 20% of inputs. So, for example, let's say there's like 100 dekes that work in hockey. And hey, check this out, by the way. Look at what I got going on here. So let's say there's like 100 dekes that work in hockey. Or that exist in hockey. Really, only, 20 of them are going to work that well, or work most of the time. And if you go even further, only 4 of them would work 96% of the time. So essentially what we're saying is that this is kind of like a power law distribution, where a certain amount, and this should be curved, but I don't have the technical chops to do that up. There is a smaller number of things that lead to really great results. So the best do the basics better. And in my perspective, a lot of players end up focusing on these different activities here. Sometimes things that are maybe the 20 to 40% or 40 to 60% of skills that are kind of on these edge case scenarios, like flipping the puck on their stick and doing twirls with their stick. They focus on these things, and then they end up getting not very good results in games from them, because they maybe are useful, but they don't account for a lot of performance. Whereas the best do the basics better. So for example, they might get really good at the hip drop fake, or they might get really good at the hip scissor or the corkscrew. These skills, these mechanics, fall in here, and they account for a larger portion of results. Now, what you're looking at here is, at the end with this greenish level here, is potentially the idea of the skills that separate. So we can assume that if you're in the NHL, you have a strong mastery of the 20% of skills that make 80% of the results, and you're probably doing a good job even along the 40% of skills that generate the rest of your results, and even the 60-80%. what you might see with Kane and Crosby is an uptick in production based on these last set of skills here, the skills that separate, as Belfry talks about them. But the thing that we should not forget is that these players have not forgotten about this chunk here, right? They have this chunk mastered. And so when Belfry's talking about the skills that separate, he might be talking about these skills here, and maybe they do provide a big separation. But if you're a young player looking to develop, you might not want to focus your attention here because you might be able to get more results, more performance from this side of the graph. So I don't know if this is true. I really don't. But what I'm proposing to you is a new way of thinking about skill development so that we're not hyper-focused on these edge case scenarios, and we treat them the way they should probably be treated, which is that once you've mastered, certainly once you've mastered this, and then once you've mastered this, then you might want to apply this. I see too many players thinking about, oh, mastering these edge case things before they have the basics lined up, and that could account for much more performance in game. So with that said, let's talk about what a linear crossover is. So here's kind of my visualization of it. You see here on the left, we have a linear crossover, and here we have curvilinear crossovers. What is that exactly? My thought is that it's sort of like this. You have this section here of normal strides, so you're skating in a straight line, and then you take one crossover, let's say to the right, and then you keep skating like that. Whereas a curvilinear crossover is many crossovers, chop, 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 in kind of this curvy line. Now, there's a really great clip here from Adam Nicholas from Stride Envy, who's worked with Belfry. I don't know to what extent, but he has. And we're going to have to wait for this to reload. But essentially, you see the difference between a linear crossover and curvilinear crossovers in this clip. So here is the straight ahead stride, as I was talking about. Here is the linear crossover, aka one crossover. Boom, one crossover, right back into linear strides. One, two, three, four. Now you're going to see the curvy linear crossovers. So it's like this. One, two, three, like that. So again, if we go back to this, we see he was skating like this, and he did one crossover, he fired off one crossover, and then went back one, two, three, four strides. And then, should have actually drawn this the other way, then he starts going back towards the net with curvilinear crossovers, with one, two, three, four crossover strides. So I'm hoping that that makes sense to you visually. Now, I'm gonna propose a new name for linear crossovers versus curvilinear crossovers, because I think there's a lot of confusion. And my proposed name is one crossover versus many crossovers, because that's kind of all it looks like to me. Because you still change direction. You're kind of skating forward. You fire off one crossover. It's not directly linear, as the name would imply. But it is one stride, whereas a lot of times you might see like two crossovers, then two crossovers back, or you might just see crossovers in a curve again and again and again. But really what it is, when every time Belfry and Adam Nicholas seem to refer to it, is it's just skating in a straight line, one crossover, and then skating in a straight line. So let's go back and look at a few examples of that. Well, so let's look at this McDavid one. We'll blow this up for you. And here's all his happy fans. Okay, let's count this out. McDavid gets the puck, passes it. So one, two, three, four strides. So one, two, three, four strides. Here, watch this, one crossover. Boom. Now, what is he doing? Oh, crossover back the other way. So that's sort of like a linear crossover. I think they were using an example of that. But that's one example. Another example is. That's not an example of it, but this one. So here's Cain. Belfry refers to this one as being three linear crossovers. So there's kind of like one crossover. Now watch, there's the strides. Here is a linear crossover. There is some strides. There's another crossover. There's another crossover, and then some strides. So you can see, I think when these guys are doing these supposed linear crossovers, they still are changing direction, right? They are still actually changing their direction, but they're just doing one at a time instead of multiple on a curve. So let's talk about why you might do that. So you'll see here that. And you saw that in the Kane clip, and we'll rewatch that Kane clip. But if your defender's skating along back at top speed, and you fire off your one crossover, you all of a sudden create a whole bunch more space, right? You're kind of tight here, and then you fire off your one crossover, and bang, you have a bit more space. So we really see Kane do a really good job of that here. Those are the curvilinear crossovers, otherwise known as many crossovers. We'll rewatch the start of this clip. So there's that. And you notice the separation that occurs, right? The skating in a straight line, all of a sudden, he created a whole bunch of separation between him and Tatar. So instead of being from here to here, now they're here, here to here apart. Now he's got a bunch more separation. Now he can do his curvilinear crossovers and score that goal. So that's kind of when we're talking about the one crossover, that's a way to do it. Now, when and why do we do this? When we use the one crossover, once called a linear crossover, it is on a straight attack at top speed. So this isn't like usually some sort of like slow moving, deceptive, wait everything out, wait the other guy out play. You're making straight attack at top speed, and it creates separation as per this little diagram here. It creates more space, separation. And the other thing it does is it changes the angle of attack. So again, your angle of attack is here. You move a little bit laterally, and now you're attacking from a slightly different angle, which just upsets the defenseman. It just really upsets the poor guy or girl who's defending. Now, the linear crossover is kind of interesting from a mechanical standpoint because there's not much different in the mechanics of a linear crossover from a curvilinear crossover, aka a one crossover from a many crossovers. I think that's what people fascinate themselves with is there a mechanical difference? That's kind of hard to see. So they don't really, it fascinates them. That's all I can say there. But the difference, I think, is player to player. So where you see like McDavid, his crossovers are different than Milan Lucic's, for example, or whatever. What I think the difference is it's the pattern. So what I think Belfry's getting at when he calls it the linear crossover, aka the one crossover, is that it's a pattern of the pros. And what we call a pattern of the pro is how pros implement skills to achieve in-game outcomes. So, for example, on the rush to create separation and change the angle of attack, you use a one crossover. So the outcomes are separation and angle of attack. The mechanic you use in that situation is the one crossover mechanic. I don't see too much of a difference in the mechanics. Like I say, it differs player to player. The one thing you might suggest is that the linear crossover or the one crossover is bigger. It covers more distance. And we talk about that. I've written about that with a article called The Tipped Hip, which is how McDavid is able to get more range, get more speed, and how he finds his crossovers get more range. So, like I said, I'm nowhere near qualified to talk about this since I'm not Daryl Belfry. I can't read his mind. But I'm hoping that this explanation of kind of my analysis and breakdown of the one crossover is helpful to you. If I'm completely off my rocker and missing maybe the gist of it, please let me know. Let me know what you think. And if there's anything that made a lot of sense to you, let me know that as well so that I can kind of double down on that explanation and use it to help people in the future. So this has been a fun discussion, one that you guys have asked me for. Like I said, let me know if I'm off my rocker or if things are making sense. I'd like to know. And leave a like if you enjoyed this video. I'll make more like it. And make sure to subscribe in the bottom right. And if you'd like to check out what we're doing at Train 2.0, the system that we're using to develop players, particularly the 80-20 system, and how we're using the magic mechanics and patterns of the pros to help players achieve in-game outcomes, you can learn more about that by clicking on the link in the top right corner or anywhere on your screen where it should be a little button that says learn more now. Anyway, thanks very much for watching, and we'll see you soon.